magic blue pen, right? Brilliance is in the magic blue pen. Allowed you to go back and correct your exams. We're going to do modern and postmodern resilience. This is how I do it. Okay, who knows? Maybe one of you or a few of you in class may be inspired by my teaching. You may want to be a professor someday in economics or finance or marketing or something. The economists that I basically grew up with and was trained by, we did everything on the board. We did art. We didn't do PowerPoints. We do everything by hand. So the first thing I do is I draw the capital allocation line. The expected return on the portfolio and the standard deviation. Then what I do is I go right here and put it in the market basket. Then I go like that, and then I go like that, and then I draw in the umbrella. Then I do my 100% stock portfolio, do my 100% bond portfolio. I put in feasible portfolios in the efficient frontier, along the efficient frontier. So we want to make sure that the utility curves are tangent, capital allocation line can be efficient. And the other utility curves, one, two, three, and my arrows, because we all want to be up here, right? High return, low risk. You can't put together a quick play out there or something. What I do is I put the optimal portfolio. Expect a return on portfolio. Stock. I kind of set up the basis of the portfolio theory. Then what I can do, if I want more return, and I'm willing to take on more risk, I can sell off my bonds, buy more stock, and move up the efficient frontier. If I want less risk, and I'm willing to take less return, I can sell off my stocks and buy more bonds and move down the efficient frontier. If I want a lot of return, I want to leverage up my return, what I can do is I can actually jump off the efficient frontier and move up the capital allocation line through the use of leverage. And I can margin my stock account or mortgage that real estate. I want to buy $100,000 worth of stock. I only got $50,000. I can borrow the other $50,000 from the brokerage firm at 9% and buy the $100,000 that I want. 50 by our money, and I use 50,000 of the permanent record deed amount. I can buy $1 million piece of property, commercial property, right? I got 500,000, it costs $1 million. I can put up the 500,000, and I can borrow the 50,000 from the bank. I only put up 500,000, and I bought $1 million property, because I borrowed from the bank. So I'm leveraging, I'm using borrowed money to basically leverage up my return if I'm right. So through margining my stock account, mortgaging my property, I can leverage up my portfolio, move up off the efficient frontier onto the capital allocation line, and get a higher rate of return without a significantly higher risk. When you add margin and mortgage, your cash flows become more volatile along with your returns. Also, jump off the efficient frontier and down the capital allocation line. Through the process of lending. So I'm a bank. You want to borrow money from me. I'll lend you that $500,000, but your property's going to be collateral. So if you default on the loan, I'm going to foreclose on the property that I'm going to take. So they're securitized loans. They're backed by the collateral, the asset in which you lent on. It's safer. It's a safer bet. And through that process, I can lower my return, but I can significantly lower my risk. So, historically, when we built portfolios, the market portfolio, assumes that you're maximizing the expected rate of return at the given level of risk. So at this point right here, this risk-adjusted rate of return, is maximized. The goal at the end of the day is to achieve a target expected rate of return of all investors. Institutional investors, endowments, pension funds, high net worth individuals, retirees, they want one thing. They want an expected return of 8 to 10% per year forever. Why? Because if you can achieve that, your money will double in less than 10 years. You get $1 million, it's $2 million in less than 10 years. Less than 10 years after that, it goes to $4 million. Less than 10 years from that, it goes to $8 million. So you can double your money in less than 10 years. Every 10 years, if you can get an 8 to 10% rate of return. Everybody wants that. So you can provide that. The goal then becomes to reduce the portfolio standard deviation. So you target the expected return, and you try to minimize and push down portfolio risk. How do you do that? Through diversification. And what do you need for diversification? You need to be able to add assets to the portfolio whose returns have no low or negative correlation with stocks and bonds. You get diversification by adding assets whose returns have no low or negative revelation the three turns. This is your goal. Now the problem was in the 40s, 50s, 60s, and even in the 70s. 40s, 50s, 60s. It was just bonds and stocks. The allocation was 70% bonds and 30% stocks. And it wasn't really until the 70s and 80s, particularly the 80s, when real estate. Brought in the portfolio. And Gibbonson and Associates added real estate to the multi-asset portfolio, the stock bond portfolio, and said you have to have all pension funds, all endowment, all risk-averse investors, everybody should have at least 10%. Wealth and their cash flows going into real estate. Because real estate has characteristics that stocks and bonds don't have. Their cash flows are tied to inflation, and their asset prices are tied to inflation. When inflation goes up, interest rates go up, bond prices go down, stock prices go down. But when inflation goes up, cash flows are adjusted to inflation for real estate. And because you put so much money into the capital asset to maintain it, you're using inflation-adjusted material, so actually the price, the value of the real estate goes up tied to inflation. Stocks and bonds don't have. So real estate has no lower negative correlation to stocks and bonds. So it's a natural asset class to put in with your stocks and bonds. So we said since real estate has bond-like characteristics, because it pays the cash flows, the rents, then we're going to take from the bonds. We're going to give it to real estate. We're going to allow stocks to still have their 30%. So that was the market basket. Then in the 90s, Gibbonson did the research again and found out that cash value life insurance also has one of the negative correlation in their returns to stocks and bonds. They're running this. So they said, okay, we ran the mathematics. Cash value life insurance should have 10%. Real estate should have 10%. Stocks should maintain this 30% that we'll take from bonds. That became the model portfolio, market portfolio, market basket in the 1990s. Then I did some research and I said, and then Deutsche Bank did some research, which was the real estate arm of this. Came up with a white paper, just like Gibbonson did for the real estate and the life insurance, and they said that alternative renewable energy as an asset class should get 10% of the institutional retail portfolios. Even though there's not a lot of investments out there now, they should get 10%. So for the 2000s, the model target portfolio is going to be 40% bonds, 30% stock, 10% real estate, 10% cash value life insurance. This is permanent life insurance issued by mutual insurance companies, New York Life, Northwestern, Ohio, large mutual companies. And then 10% will go to alternative renewable energy. Solar farms, geothermal, biogas, community choice aggregation, utilities. Because you'd want to include these alternative assets in your stock bond portfolio because their returns have low no net correlation. And once you include these assets into the stock bond portfolio, this is the key parts of everybody. Please, please, please follow along. This is the point I look at when I look at your exams. This is what I'm looking for. Is what it does is it bows out the emission criteria. It bows out the emission criteria. When you bow out the emission criteria, yes, expected returns are going to fall, but your standard deviation falls even more. So even though you're getting a reduction in your expected return, you're getting significant reduction in the portfolio standard deviation of the risk, which increases your risk-adjusted rate of return. If you're still getting 8 to 10%, you're better off, and all risk-averse investors are better off. You're better off. Now the bonus here, unfortunately, if you are a principal of a family office or a corporation or a bank, you have huge human capital. If you were to pass away or something was to happen to you, a lot of people within your family, in your corporation, bank, you sit on nonprofits, that would be extremely disruptive for everybody around you. So the solution is the cash value life insurance. So you take on large amounts of life insurance with as large of a death benefit as you can afford. Obviously, you have to pay premiums for that life insurance, which is going to reduce the expected return. But if the principal does pass away, or when the principal passes away, because this cash value life insurance is permanent, it's guaranteed to pay out at some point in time. If the principal passes away, the death benefit goes into the portfolio, and the expected return jacks vertically under a higher utility curve so that the beneficiaries of the portfolio are better off. This is where they wanted to be originally. They couldn't get there with any of the assets that were available in the capital markets. Through the use of cash value life insurance, principal doesn't benefit, but beneficiaries benefit by inheriting the estate and the portfolio at a higher expected return to give you the risk. So they're significantly better off at the end of the day. Not only did the principal get reduced portfolio standard deviation, but also the beneficiaries got significant expected return from the portfolio. That's what I'm looking for. What other ones? Are you clear on the derivative trades? Oh, here's the other thing that's really interesting. Is the derivative trades. If I think that the value of my portfolio is going to go down because the prices, stocks, and bonds, real estate, alternative renewable energy prices are going to go down. I might be able to find an index that's correlated to the assets in my portfolio. And I probably invested in exchange traded funds in my portfolio, and I definitely have stock. Definitely have stocks in my portfolio. So if I think that the prices are going to go down and my returns are going to go down, I can hedge off. I can hedge off the risk, the market risk. By applying portfolio insurance, the use of derivatives. And how would I do that? Give me the trades. What are the trades? I think prices are going to go down. What are my trades?
Right forwards, right futures, right calls on futures, buy puts on futures.
So I would write forwards, right futures, calls on futures, and I would buy puts on futures. I could do that. If I have ETFs and stocks in my portfolio, and I think the prices are going to go down, how do I hedge off of that?
So short, right, calls and buy puts.
So short. Calls. Now here's the deal. If I apply these derivatives to my portfolio through the use of financial engineering, it also goes out the other. I can bow out the efficient frontier through diversification into alternative assets. I can also bow out the efficient frontier through financial engineering using the derivatives. That's it. That's the total solution. That's your 2 years of finance concentration in one lecture. Everything revolves around this. The whole finance field revolves around this. The valuations, the securities that are in there. You understand this, you can go forward. Firms use this model to have a private company. I'm building out product lines and divisional lines. I want diversification and the cash flows across the divisional lines so that I can get diversification. I know what my cash flow returns are going to be. If my cash flows for the different divisional lines, my product or service, have low, no, or negative correlation with each other, it's going to go off the efficient frontier. I can target, expect a return, and lower the portfolio standard deviation even more by risk adjusted rate of return. And people will flock into our stock. Because that's what they do. What about the S-curves? People have a problem with the S-curves. Now, S-curves look like this. They look like that. They look like S's. So they have little tails. They go like that. Those are S curves. S1, S2, S3, S4. This is time. This is technology. And the goal at the end of the day is to be able to develop new technologies, new financial products, new technologies consistently over time to be able to convey to the marketplace your ability successfully develop new technologies over time, basically drive a revenue growth path. Is it the marketplace sees that you're successful in developing these products over and over again? Maybe they use earnings per share to value your company. You can establish the growth path. This goes up, the value of your company goes up. You can maximize the growth in your revenue and your free cash flows and your earnings for the firm. You're going to maximize the value of the firm. That's the goal. And the product adoption cycle, same thing. This is technology. Product adoption is financial products. It's similar. What stage is this? Innovator. So the first adopters that adopt your product, and then all of a sudden, boom. What's this called? What? Early majority, but what is this thing called? The phase is early majority. What? This is your hockey stick. It's called the hockey. I didn't make this up, but the venture capitalists did. Okay, the tech firms did. That's called the hockey stick. That's when your revenue and your earnings growth and the valuation of your firm is increasing exponentially and potentially vertically. All of a sudden, bam, everybody is adopting your product. And then what's this? What phase is that? Majority. Majority, laggards. So if you're a one product firm, one financial product firm, you're toast. Right? You're going to go through this and then you're done. You need to take it out and the value of your stock's going to go down and somebody's going to buy you out. But that's not the goal. That's not what Apple or Salesforce or IBM or Cisco or New York Life, Goldman Sachs, Merrill Lynch, B of A, Wells Fargo, they don't do that. I don't know if I'll be able to do that. So their goal is to create multiple products over time and create a revenue path curve, clearly communicate to the marketplace their ability to grow the cash flows consecutively over time to be able to maximize the firm and the stock price. So that's the objective. Okay. Yeah, this is the point. Is right here, you're spending a lot of money, but nobody's buying your stuff. Nobody's buying your product. You sunk a lot of money into developing. All of a sudden, because of now with social media, right, in other forms of instantaneous mass communications and marketing, all of a sudden everybody hooks onto your product and they all start buying it. Your revenues, your growth, your employment, your sales, your profits, everything starts to increase significantly at an increasing rate. A lot of times, companies go out of business here because the people who are running the company have never been through this before. Usually bring in the best management who knows how to handle rapid growth within the firm. Then even before you're done getting in the majority, you've already developed a new product and you do it again. So you're developing new products consistently over time. You're developing new technologies consistently over time. To basically generate a revenue growth path to maximize the value of the firm. You can do that. You're right. I mean, I built a stock portfolio over the last 5 years, my portfolio, my tech portfolio has done 20% per year for the last 5 years. It was all tech, it's all based on this model. I did financial services in 3 months. But the model's basically the same. You can apply to different industries. Okay, one other thing on the exam. Regression equation. How about the regression equation? I'm looking for the regression. Right off the bat, that's the first thing I look for. Do you understand the regression equation? I don't want more than 5 variables in my line. That's the first thing I look for. And then I think for some of you on the pre-test, you're still having problems. Where if you build a model and you have 2 variables that are highly correlated to each other and highly correlated to the dependent variable, which one? How do you decide which one to keep and which one to take out?
You go through the peer reviews in the literature, or the models that I've done it, and see which ones they use.
Yeah, exactly. This one might have a significant T statistic, or correlation, dependent variable. But this one's been cited a lot in the literature, in the peer review journal, in industry research, articles between industry and academia. This one has a pretty good T too and a pretty good correlation too. Maybe not as good as this one, but this one's been cited for this. This one doesn't. That's how you solve for multi-collinear. Okay. Everybody understand the derivative traits for an up when prices go up? My forwards, my futures, my calls on futures, my puts on futures. Buy on margin, buy calls on puts. What the ETF says. You still don't have that? Okay, that's okay. What else? What else is on here? What else are you missing? This is the most important. That's the one where everybody messes because they don't get the utility curve tangent to the capital allocation of the efficient frontier and they don't follow the efficient. Trying to help you. What are your thoughts on monetary policy?
The technical analysis.
Technical analysis. Price patterns. So this is basically a pattern. Those stocks, you know, have the same type of price. The first thing I would do when I see this is I look at the support. First support line, then the resistance. Now you can see that the stock price is bounded at the top and bounded at the bottom. It's going to be called a trading range. It's also called range bound. It's also called accumulation. It's also called consolidation. It's also called the sideways patterns. Sideways pattern. here. Back out. Here's the upside. Broke out the hips. And then the stop was on one. Right up. Down. Up again. Okay, down. Get another support. Resistance. Another breakout. Peak. Here it broke out. To downside. Another resistance. Support. Another training range right here. Work out. Training in the range. Work out to the downside again. As you can see, there's an upward trend. Downward trend. If you want to get a little more fancy schmancy, this piece right here is called the head and shoulders. Here is the head. Basically, fundamental, rudimentary, stock technical analysis. Okay. That's kind of what I was looking for. And you can just list the other, just the types of technical analysis, just list. But that's the technical chart. Okay, what else? Supply and demand analysis. You can do the individual supply and demand charts if you want to, or you can do one consolidated. What? Am I out of time? So what I like to do is supply first. Pick an asset class. Supply, demand. Supply, demand.
Star. 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 Star's the same thing as equilibrium.
It's equilibrium. So I like to set it. Okay. Then we're going to do stocks. The supply curve shifts back. Quantity supplied shifts back. And prices go up. What would be the cause of that? Stop taking that. Got it. The supply curve shifts out. Supply shifts out, prices drop. What would cause the supply curve to shift out? Initial public offerings, we're seasoned, we're secondary. Got it. Looking for a lot and just looking to see if you understand the microeconomics and the factors that are going to shift the supply and demand curves back and out and up and down. What would cause the demand curve to shift up? Cause the quantity demanded to shift out? Prices to move up? What would do that? Well, people are buying stock. Buying stock and selling bonds. Why would they do that? Why would they buy bonds and sell their stock? Because stocks are going to provide them with a higher rate of return. You're right, maybe higher GDP growth rate expectations, higher demand. Earnings. Earnings expectations, lower interest rates, the cost of capital, could all be factors that would shift the demand curve. What would shift the demand curve down? Shift the demand curve down so the quantity demanded back and prices drop. So if it's easy, you just do the opposite. Okay. So if you're going to sell stock, buy bonds, lower returns, lower GDP, lower earnings, higher interest rates, and higher market rents. Put oil in here, it caused the supply curve to shift back in oil, cut back some oil by the OPEC cartel. What would cause the supply curve to shift out? Fracking. Export, global exporting by the U.S. What would cause the demand curve to shift up for oil? Increase global gross domestic product. Production, consumption, investment. What would cause the demand curve to shift back? Recessions. Slow down anything growth in the economy. In regards to gold, what would cause the supply curve to shift back? Just lack of demand, or just they can't produce enough. Or they're cutting back on its private property prices, which I've never heard. What would cause the supply curve to shift out? Maybe they find new technology to be able to mine for, to find gold and mine for gold. So there's a push, you know, of gold supply into the marketplace because of new technology. What would cause demand for gold to go up? Inflation fears, political instability. The main two factors. What would cause demand for gold to go down? Rising interest rates. Lower inflation. Political stability. People would go up. Bonds. What would cause the supply curve to shift back for bonds? Budget surpluses, where the government goes back in and basically retires the bonds in the marketplace. It's all in 190. What would cause the supply curve to shift out? Large budget deficits, where the government needs to fund those deficits by issuing more bonds, and there's not enough demand. What would cause the demand curve for bonds to go up? Fear, for one. And the other is more risk in the stock market, so they go into the bond market, and deceleration in the economy, and disinflation through deflation. What would cause the demand curve for bonds to go down? Higher inflation, higher interest rates, higher expected returns in the stock market, and in gold. And then foreign currency, when you're looking at the US dollar, the prices turn to values. It would cause the supply curve to shift back. Well, the Federal Reserve and the Treasury starts to buy US dollars and sell foreign currency to devalue the currency. What would cause the supply curve of dollars to shift out? The printing of money by the Federal Reserve. It would increase foreign dollars. Or a sale of dollars by not only the US Treasury and Central Bank, but also other treasuries and other central banks in other countries. What would cause the demand curve for the dollar to go up? Higher expected returns in the United States on stocks and real estate. Lower expected inflation rates compared to other countries. Higher interest rates in the United States compared to other foreign countries would cause demand for the dollar to appreciate. And what would cause the dollar to depreciate? Would be higher inflation rates in the United States compared to foreign currencies. Lower interest rates in the United States compared to other foreign countries. Lower expected returns on real estate and stocks in the United States compared to other foreign countries. That's kind of what I was looking for. Because that's the microeconomic analysis behind your numbers, and behind all analysis that you're doing when you're tracking these markets. What else? How am I doing on time? Yield curves? Yield curves? Let's do yield curves here. And then tell me when you're just burned. Let's just do yield curves real quick. Upward slope, upward sloping curve. You guys got to put the Fisher equation in. I'll actually go with the rest of this. If you have questions, we'll give you an hour on Wednesday. You come see me on Wednesday if you want more help. So, are inflation expectations positive, negative, or zero?
Positive.
And then for a flat curve?
Zero.
Put the equation in, and when they're inverted?
Negative.
When the curve inverts, when does the stock market peak? How many months?
12.
When do we fall into a recession?
24.
Excellent. What is the reason why the Federal Reserve hasn't been able to get to its GDP target? Quantity theory of money. Quantity theory of money.
Because the level of labor is so high.
She got it. She got it. Already, they can't do that. They can't do that. They can't do this anymore because they got $4.5 trillion on the balance sheet already. So this is off the table. So the only way that they can solve this to get to 3% is they got to get this to go up. And what's the number one factor that drives velocity up?
Labor
participation. That's the labor market. But they can't pass labor policy. So you basically would be looking at lower inflation and GDP than what you hit their target. Interest rates go down, what direction the bond prices go?
Up.
Interest rates go up, what direction the bond prices go?
Down.
Okay. If the yield curve shifts up, and interest rates go up, what direction do stock and bond and real estate prices go?
Down.
Yield curve goes down. What direction do stock, bond, real estate prices go up? Who control? What end of the curve does the Federal Reserve control? Short, medium, or long?
Short.
Short. Do they have a direct or indirect impact on short-term interest rates?
Direct.
What about medium and long?
Indirect.
Excellent. You guys are awesome. Do you need the valuation? You can do those things. Bring it back, work on it. Matthew 10. All rooms. Make sure you keep, the cover pages. Thank you, everybody. People slow down after this.